Hello, I'm Terry Schwartzbeck of the Alliance for Excellent Education. Welcome and thank you for joining us. Today, I will be your moderator for what will be a very special webinar about the need for districts to act now to develop plans that incorporate the use of technology in school improvement efforts. Before we get started, I actually want to turn it over to Alliance President Governor Bob Wise, who would like to kick things off with an important message.
Thank you very much, Terry. So let me open up with this. I'd like to start by saying one thing. If you're getting ready to invest in laptops, tablets, or any other digital learning resources, stop. That's right, I want you to stop. Don't write a check or sign a purchase order until you've listened to this webinar and you have a comprehensive plan for what you want to accomplish with digital learning. So now that I think I have your attention, I want to take a step back and look around. American education has made tremendous progress in the last decade or so. Greater emphasis is being placed on ensuring that every student, including those low-income students and students of color that have been traditionally disadvantaged, that they achieve their potential. And yet, we know, you know, that major challenges remain. As states have moved to requiring all students be college and career ready, several other forces are combining that will require districts, all 15,000 of our school districts, to seriously and systematically plan for how they can implement effective digital learning strategies to meet these challenges. This is an epic time for decision making. Too few students today are prepared for college and career readiness. Graduation rates remain low, around 72% for most students. For minority students, closer to 50%. And meanwhile, of those that do graduate, only 1 in 4 is actually ready for college-level work. Meanwhile, as our economy slowly recovers, more and more jobs require some kind of training after high school, post-secondary work in some form. We know that to address this issue, students need learning opportunities that are more hands-on and experiential and project-based, aligned to student interest. They need opportunities to produce content, to analyze information, and build deeper knowledge of complex topics. And what we're seeing across the country, and what we saw on the first National Digital Learning Day, is a technology that can make learning more challenging and motivating. But at the same time, school leaders everywhere are forced to make hard choices and budget cuts. And that's why we've issued this report, The Nation's Schools Are Stepping Up to Higher Standards, that focuses on exactly what are those hard choices that each of you is going to have to make in the next 2 years. That's right, in the next 2 years. We know that for most districts, revenues are going to be slow to increase. Districts today must be able to do more with less. These tough budgets include challenges for teaching staffs. Nearly 300,000 teacher jobs have been lost since 2008. And today's typical teacher has just 1 or 2 years of experience compared to 15 years in 1987. These teachers are stretched to the limits of their capacity and report that they have a hard time meeting the needs of each student. And states also are struggling to fill hard-to-staff positions in physics and chemistry and many other subjects. What teachers need are the tools that allow them to teach each child, to seek those aha moments, and to help those who need it. They need the most advanced resources to provide rich, relevant learning opportunities in ways that meet each student's individual needs and ensure that all students have the opportunity to get in the driver's seat of their own learning. Now, more critically, in the next 24 months, let me say that again, the next 2 years or the next 24 months, you leaders in districts and schools are going to be facing some very specific challenges. The implementation of new online assessments tied to college and career-ready standards in 46 states in the District of Columbia, that means the Common Core standards. Number two, more states are receiving waivers or participating in Race to the Top, or I-3, meaning the future of assessment and accountability is rapidly decentralizing. 40 states will most likely have waivers by this year's end. Number three, you're going to continue to face hard budget times, so any purchasing decision you do make has to be must maximize your efficiency and effectiveness. And you also have another challenge. and that is the rapid explosion of technology with price points dropping, so you have a lot more choices. But what's the right choice, and how does it integrate with what you're trying to do in terms of achieving gains and learning outcomes? You've really only got two budget cycles before these online assessments go online, have to be administered. You're thinking about how you're going to get your teachers the professional learning and development they need. You're thinking, how are you going to get your school wired enough to handle hundreds of students taking an assessment at the same time? And you're also wondering, with all of this going on, how you're going to keep that laser-like focus on student achievement and growth. What we're seeing across the country, and as our panelists today will tell us, systemic and effective use of technology and digital learning can connect students to better teaching and learning experiences while also addressing three major challenges facing the nation's education system: access to good teaching, tight budgets, and raising student achievement. Now, what do I mean when I say digital learning? This is important because there are a lot of different terms out there, and they can mean different things. To the Alliance, digital learning is any instructional practice that is effectively using technology to strengthen the student learning experience. This can include blended learning, integration of open educational resources and Web 2.0 resources such as social media, blogging, and connections to the world outside of the school. Better use of data, making it a real tool and friend for teachers. It means learning that is 24/7, any time, any place, any path, any pace. And digital learning is a platform for high-quality professional learning for teachers and for relevant, hands-on, project-based, deeper learning experiences for students. It is learning that gives students an opportunity to drive their own learning, to produce, create, and explore. I'm very excited about those that are joining us today, and I turn this back over to our moderator, Terry.
Thanks, Bob. So what you described, this message about the need to make these decisions in the next 24 months, that's the reason we're here today with this great group of panelists. So I'll go ahead and introduce them to you now. First, here in the studio with us today, I'm so pleased to have Brian Lewis, who is the Chief Executive Officer of the International Society for Technology in Education, or ISTE. Brian took the helm at ISTE earlier this year, having previously served as the interim CEO at the National Board for Professional Teaching Standards, where, Governor, you serve on the board as well. Brian also has been an elected school board member and executive director of the California Association of School Business Officials with a wide range of K-12 experience. Also on the phone today, we're lucky to have two other wonderful guests. First, Ryan Imbriale. Ryan is currently doing some very exciting work as the principal of Patapsco High School in Maryland. He's been the assistant principal at Perry Hall High School, as well as an e-learning specialist and a facilitator of the Maryland Students Online Consortium. He teaches classes in project-based learning, school leadership, and advanced instructional strategies at the Johns Hopkins University, and has also been on the board of directors at ISTE. Thank you very much for joining us today, Ryan. And finally,
thank you very much for having me.
Sure, thanks. Also on the phone, we have Keisha Ray. Keisha is executive director of learning technologies for the Metropolitan Nashville Public Schools, where she oversees planning and administration of the district's virtual school, blended learning, online professional development, and instructional technology integration. She's also the president-elect at ISTE. She has been a middle school science teacher, and throughout her career, she's worked in both research and practice on instructional technology, instructional design, and digital media. So Keisha, Ryan, thank you so much for joining us today. For those of you watching, let me give you a little information about how this webinar will progress. You'll notice we have a chat box at the bottom of this webinar page, so please use this space to submit questions for all our panelists. We will turn to those questions as often as we can during the next hour. Brian, I'm going to start with you. First, why don't you just tell us a little bit about ISTE and why you see these as some of the most exciting times for ISTE's mission?
Thank you, Terry. I think for the very reasons that the governor has just mentioned, it almost feels like the great work that ISTE has done over the last many years has prepared it to be in a position to support exactly the things that the governor is talking about. What I've learned about ISTE in a very short period of time from the inside is it is this rich, diverse, inspired community of professionals across the spectrum who are and have genuinely inspired me. They are there to support one another, and they're just there to support everyone to accomplish the goals that the governor is talking about. All the programs and services that the association has generated and offers are about helping other professionals address these very issues. And so I think as we begin this planning, as folks are beginning planning or reevaluating their current planning, ISTE is the place where you can go within that community to find folks across teachers and curriculum, deputy curriculum instruction folks, CTOs, superintendents, principals. You have a colleague in ISTE and colleagues in ISTE who are there in a very genuine way to help you achieve the goals that you have in your district.
Well, and it's wonderful to be able to partner with ISTE because, Brian, what I've always been impressed by in attending ISTE meetings is the incredible talent pool. I mean, you've got an amazing teacher membership base, principals
Absolutely.
And others. Go to any ISTE conference and you see literally thousands. I think you had 18,000
over 18,000,
alone, and they're all on the cutting edge of what's happening in educational technology.
Absolutely, you know what inspired me going to the ISTE conference this last summer was the ISTE members and leaders set the example for the fact that as human beings we all learn in different ways. I've never seen such a diversity of learning opportunities as the members and leaders of ISTE put together at the ISTE conference. You know, we all want to learn in different ways. We have different comfort levels. It was mind-blowing. It's really phenomenal what they do.
Absolutely. Now we've already got a question from the audience. What are some of the biggest challenges that district leaders face when they're trying to plan strategically to implement technology to reach these goals? What makes this so hard?
Well, I think and I think the governor alluded to this as well, and I think it's really where ISTE is. You know, a number of years ago, it was about breaking that wall down about technology, getting the technology in the classroom, gaining familiarity and comfort level with it. It's really now where ISTE is, you know, philosophically now, is it's really about what are our goals relative to teaching and learning, and how is the technology supporting that? And that gets to the governor's point about the plan. It really is about stepping back and having that conversation as a district, as a leadership team, with the teachers, with the parents, with the community, and having a conversation about what is it we're trying to do with technology. In ISTE's case, you know, foundational to our operation are our technology standards for administrators, for teachers, for students, and they're available online. They're an enormous resource to folks. No matter where you are on that planning cycle, they're a resource to you. And so I think foundationally it's that conversation you have as a school community in your district, that conversation that brings the stakeholders in and says, this is where we want to go. And once we have that plan, we can thoughtfully make those decisions about scarce dollars and how we allocate them, I think.
Well, and Bob, that gets at what you've often said about the three T's and how you go about this kind of planning. What you always start with the strategy.
Yeah, the strategy that we envision and we're working with a number of other partners such as ISTE and other membership organizations is around developing a strategy template. And so first you set your goals, your student outcome learning goals, and for many it's going to be implementing the Common Core standards. Then what are your unique challenges that each school and district faces, whether it's a high population of free and reduced lunch, lack of connectivity when a student goes home, and then the three T's. And you start with the teaching. How is what you're going to do with digital learning change teaching and enhance the role of the teacher, making them truly an educational designer? The second T is time. How do you change the use of time all the way from in the classroom to perhaps flipping the classroom to competency-based advancement? And now you get to the third T, which is, so what is the appropriate technology? You've set for your goals, for your challenges, for improving teaching. Now you're much better able to decide what's the appropriate technology for what you're trying to achieve rather than buying the technology and then saying, okay, let's make it work. And I know that those our practitioners on the phone deal with this every day.
Exactly. That's a great, let's turn to Ryan on the phone first. Ryan, start by just telling us a little bit about your school and what makes it special. I know you do a lot of arts. Tell us more.
Well, Patapsco is a special place because really what we have is this top-notch arts magnet program that includes visual arts, theater, music, and dance. And that's layered on top of a comprehensive high school with a full slate of every athletic program that you can think of, over 20 AP course offerings, and, of course, countless clubs and after-school activities. So it's a school that serves both the neighborhood in and around Dundalk, Maryland, and also students throughout Baltimore County because of the magnet component. over 50% of our student population is on free and reduced lunch, and that's up from 25% in just 4 years. So during this transition here at Patapsco, we've not only been able to maintain our success, but build on that, on our successes. And we're very proud to be recognized by two national publications last year, both the Washington Post and U.S. News and World Report. And the College Board recognized us as one of the top high schools in America for arts integration. And really what happens with our magnet program and our arts program is you really have an atmosphere of creativity, innovation, and exploration. And this kind of can-do, failure is okay mentality about learning that permeates the school. And technology is really a major part of this culture and approach to learning here at Patapsco. And so from the technology standpoint, our students and our staff know that we're really not afraid to be bold and to try new and innovative approaches to instruction, whether that's things like BYOD or blended learning or using social media. It's really an atmosphere where, as I said before, failure is not negative. Instead, it's really a part of the growth process. However, as Bob and Brian have both mentioned, it's not haphazard at all. A matter of fact, I'm blessed to work in a large school district, and from that standpoint, here in Baltimore County, I use here in my building a pilot proposal process for when we're looking at technology, and it really does kind of touch on what Bob talked about with the three keys and looking at goals and unique challenges. And we really do focus on, you know, what's the instructional rationale, what research questions are we looking to answer, what student outcomes are we looking for, what's the experimental design, what kind of professional development would be necessary to implement what we're looking at, what's then the rationale for the hardware selection, and then ensuring that we have a timeline in place and that we really have an evaluation plan in place. So, like I said, although we're willing to be bold and we try new things, we do it purposefully.
That sounds exactly like what so many other districts around the country are struggling to do and trying to find the right way. I want to address another question from the audience from Chris in Kentucky. One of the questions we get a lot is, how are district leaders working to address barriers to access outside the school, especially when you mentioned, Ryan, that you have students who might be in poverty? So subscriptions, device costs, availability, all of those things. Have you had to address that issue at Patapsco?
You know, so a lot of that is about building relationships with your constituents. And so here at Patapsco, we spend a lot of time working all those different relationship angles, creating the partnerships in the business community, ensuring we're meeting the needs that they're looking for. I'm a magnet school who brings students in. I also have a magnet that we send students to, where we have aeronautical engineering program and we have a cybersecurity program. And so we look at all those pieces and work with the business community in and around the Baltimore, Washington area to find out what those skill sets are that'll help students. The Patapsco High School is a school where many students are first generation college students if they go on to college. And often students in our building, due to financial constraints, their first step is community college. So it's also working K-16 and ensuring that we are partnering with our local colleges and our local community colleges to ensure that we're meeting all those needs to make sure that we have students who are career and college ready no matter what that path might take. You know, we're an art school, but it also goes as far as ensuring that we're offering diverse programs for all of our students. So, you know, STEM is a big word out there, but we like to add the A, and it's become kind of cliche these days to say STEAM a lot, but it really does make a big difference, and the A matters, and you can see it in this building.
Absolutely. Brian, in your role at ISTE, do you see similar focuses on sort of a broad set of strategies to reach those students who may or may not have access?
Yeah, I think access, equity of access is a huge issue for all of us and certainly for ISTE. You know, last month we had our first leadership forum where we had a very practical program design for teams from districts to come and have thoughtful conversation with one another and then develop actually a plan or a revision to their existing plan to go back and take, you know, very real tool to go back to their district. And a huge part of that is equity of access. What is it that we can do in each of our, everybody's circumstance is different. What is it, how do we reflect on that with our school community and look at things like equity of access in our community so that we can address that in our way that's unique? Because there are, while there are commonalities among our challenges, the unique flavor to them in our communities in every case is very unique and very different. And the challenge is the time clock that we're faced with, and yet being able to take the time that's necessary within that to have that thoughtful planning. It's you know, we know this is not easy.
Absolutely. I want to get to Keisha, and I also have so many questions here that I want to address. But Keisha, first, why don't you, again, just tell us about some of what you're doing there in Nashville.
All right. Well, Nashville is a district that is 81,000 students. We have 150 schools, 75% free and reduced lunch. And what many people don't realize about Nashville is we have 100 different countries represented in our city. So we have 135 languages. We have just a tremendous amount of diversity. So we started a plan 5 years ago that focused on college and career ready students. And we wanted to make sure that all of our kids would have the preparation they needed to be successful in college career. So we've been very systematic and deliberate with our focus on developing our students to be successful in college and career. So through that, we've woven technology. Initially, we wove it through as a supplement to the curriculum for our students that were overage and under credit, and that was able to bring our graduation rate up from 58% to 86%. We were actually highlighted in the InnoSight report for that achievement. Then we established a virtual school, and that helped us have kind of a hybrid kind of format for our kids. And then last year we did redesigning learning environments in our schools, and we got Race to the Top money, and we were able to spread that money out to 10 schools so that they could redesign learning environments with the intention of strategically using technology for student achievement and engagement. And then this year we're focused on blended learning, and that's to begin to build the skill set that the students are going to need to be familiar and successful with Common Core. And we're a park state, so with the park assessments. So we really adhere to that plan for college and career ready students, and do everything we can to intentionally weave technology through every aspect without it being an add-on or something we think about after the fact. So,
Fantastic. And it sounds like that focus on that college and career readiness is sort of the overarching umbrella, and then everything else builds up to that. I want to take a question from New Hampshire. This was directed at Ryan, but I think anyone can take it. How, Ryan, have you taken time out of the equation? Governor Wise mentioned the importance of time. How has time and the use of time maybe changed in your school as you've worked to build student success?
Well, I think here at Patapsco we're starting to really, really look at the 24-hour cycle. My school day, if you want to talk about when students are in the building, school starts at 7:45, and school just ended a few minutes ago at 2:15, and I just want to put a shout out there to my wonderful assistant principal. But, you know, school goes well beyond that now. And as we look at our options and what we're doing with, as Keisha said, blended learning and the way we're utilizing tools to communicate with parents, to keep students active at home, and to engage them 24/7, school is not what it used to be in terms of those bell schedules. And I think what we're finding is that students want to have that engagement. And so we're able to do more with, as Bob said, the flipped classroom, where teachers really are giving students the opportunity to do the independent learning on their own and really taking the time when we're face-to-face to have those engaging conversations. As again, I'm an art school, so the school is open all the time, forever, constantly. You know, this weekend is the Anatomy of Grey in our Black Box Theater, and so, but we also are streaming that, so kids who can't get there can watch the show, online. From my standpoint and from my time, you know, as an administrator and as leaders in the building, the other thing that we're doing is we're using social media to communicate. We're using various modes to get out there and share what's happening, so I don't have to be pinned behind my desk all the time. And I say to my leadership team, I want you all to be doing that, because we need to share all the good things that are happening here, and that doesn't happen from being locked in our offices.
Terry, I have to ask Keisha a question, because I was so struck, Keisha, in your description of the Nashville district. You're a large urban district. You've got an amazing diversity. You have a number of challenges. And so I guess my question to you, and yet you're systematically and strategically implementing digital learning in a very phased manner. So could you talk a little bit, please, because a lot of people interested in your experience, the challenges that you faced in doing that systematic, comprehensive planning that has to happen. What are some of the pitfalls that you've experienced, and what would you say to other district leaders that are saying, I know I've got to go down this path, but what's some practical advice for them?
Well, you know, something that we say frequently, we just remind ourselves that we're not moving like a rowboat. We're turning the Titanic. Hmm. So it's, you have to be systematic, and you have to be methodical, and you have to include as many community and parent, you know, as many members of the community as possible in the process. One of the things that we've done that I believe is a little unique is with the Learning Technology Department, which is my department. So we've separated the Learning Technology from the Information Technology side. And our Learning Technology Department is embedded in the Curriculum and Instruction side of the district. So we're at the table all the time when curriculum and instruction decisions are made. We even are at the table when we're talking about renovation and design of new schools. So we're always at the table. And that's a powerful place to be when you're talking about making sure that technology is thought of in an intentional way in the planning process. The other thing that I think that we do well is with regard to our community, we turn a lot of the planning over to the community. And our community came to us and said, this past year, for example, there are over 1,000 jobs that are vacant that are highly skilled technology jobs in Nashville, and we need you to help us fill these jobs. And we said to them, we need your help in designing a plan that can have that as the outcome, that will be the end in mind. And so they stepped up. The community stepped up. The Nashville Technology Council stepped up. C3 Consulting stepped up. They hired a project manager to be embedded in my department to design this learning technology plan. It's amazing. So we have a lot of great partnerships with businesses and community that give us the boost, if you will, to be able to implement the things that we put right into a plan. And I think that's another thing that you have to keep in mind is you can't really mandate change. You have to make sure that all of the people that are part of the transformation are connected to the transformation, and they know why it's happening, and they have a clear understanding of the direction you're going in, and they not only buy in, but they're a part of the build. And that presents a lot of power in your progress toward any kind of implementation.
So it sounds to me then like you just don't show up at a high school one day with 500 laptops and on carts and announce we're now technology driven. It's apparent.
Right. Well, we don't show up. We don't stand. The IT department people will probably cringe when I say this, but we really try to give flexibility to the school. So our mode of operation is also to have a menu of options that are available that schools can purchase from, But we don't go in and say everybody's getting an iPad or everyone's getting a this or everyone's getting a that. We let the schools drive that decision because at the end of the day, they're the ones that have to own it and implement it. And so our job is to support the schools in what they feel and know is best when they look at their students and their data and their teachers. Our job is to make their job easier. And we can do that through a partnership.
But you bring everybody in advance and clearly plan before you make those purchases.
Well, that sounds...
Absolutely.
And, you know, that brings to a couple of other questions to mind. We've got another question from Ryan's home state in Maryland about the issue around Bring Your Own Device initiatives, or BYOD, BYOT. There's sort of this idea about top-down, the district decides what the technology is going to be versus working with the districts, with the devices that are already in the school. Brian, what have you seen in terms of how these types of initiatives? Are there pitfalls, advantages?
Well, you know, it makes me think about when I was on the school board longer ago than I want to remember, 10, 12 years ago, and we were debating policy about whether or not to allow students to bring their cell phones to school. It's a very different conversation today regarding the use of technology, how is it integrated into the teaching objectives and learning objectives, what are those policies that you have to have in place at the local level. Very complex and sometimes controversial conversations around local policy with local school boards and superintendents and communities about what are, as the governor said, what are our educational goals, how is this going to support that, and then what are, you know, when you get down in the weeds, there are some complicated issues there about protection and liability that have to be thoughtfully explored. Again, I would say you don't have to do it alone. There are people who are going through this, have gone through it. There are sample policies. Again, the ISTE community is a rich resource for these things, and we live to support others who are going through it. So really, it can be a very complicated issue, but again, it goes back to what are we trying to achieve pedagogically, and then what are the conversations we have to have locally that make it work for our community? Because I was just in a conversation on this recently, and there was a little bit of a poll taken of the group gathered, and it was all over the map about where folks are. So again, community-driven and some very important policy conversations, I think, that you have to have.
Now, Brian, where can folks go? Is the ISTE website or the NET Standards, is that a place where
NET Standards
to look for...
are online, are absolutely there.
Great,
and
great.
We have, you know, we have our special interest groups that focus in different areas, and really all they need to do if they have a question is to give us a call at ISTE. We're going to connect them with their colleagues around the country and beyond with our international membership who can be resources to them, absolutely.
Fantastic. And now when it comes to getting that governance role, the school board and the leadership in the district, are there resources for them to think about how they can support their IT departments and those learning technology departments? Are there resources out there for them as well?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's the collective resource that we have as an education community. You know, you're talking about the school boards association with policies. You're talking about the administrators, the principals at the elementary and secondary level. You're talking about the national board. You're talking about organizations. Collectively, we have the resources collectively that we all need to share with one another. And I think what we want to do is support that sharing and to reinforce the message that, hey, if you need some resources, if you got a question, call one of us. We're going to be able to get the answer for you directly, or we're going to connect you with one of our colleague organizations or professionals who can get it for you. Because again, it can be very complicated and very unique in every case. And we can talk about it theoretically, we can talk about it at a broad policy level. You get down to the local level, it is very unique in every case, and we have to respect that, I think.
I'm hearing a lot about collaboration and working together and a lot about partnerships. I think that says a lot about how important this work is. Now, with the one of the other key questions that we get from a lot of folks is around how do you get the teachers prepared to do this? So, Keisha, what have you worked on in terms of training teachers and giving them the learning experiences that they can then go forth and teach in this sort of new and more effective way?
I love this question.
I know.
Because one of the things that we've done, I think, is really unique. And that is, we have hired in our department instructional designers. So part of our 5-year plan is within the structure of a school day, there's common planning. So every school, especially middle and high school, has a common planning block of time within their schedule. The instructional designers that are in my department work with a school in what I like to call push-in PD. So we go to the school, we work with the faculty, we work with them in grade level teams or in subject area teams, and we don't leave them after we put the technology in. We call it drop and drag. We don't drop the technology in and then drag our butts out and go somewhere else. We stay with the school. We make sure that they have the support and the intel that they need to do what they want to do with the technology. We help them design lessons. We help them find resources. We model lessons so we can co-develop a lesson, and then we'll teach a lesson so that they can kind of see how it is, and then they get to teach it. We'll be there on the first day if they're doing a one-to-one and having netbooks turned on by all the fifth graders in that classroom. We'll be in that room to help make sure that the netbooks work so that the teacher isn't distracted by that. So we do everything that we can to try to make sure that they are successful in their initial integration of technology. And we find that once they get through that one time, it's kind of like once you do it and you know you can, then the next time it's a little bit easier, and the next time it's a little bit easier. But we have we also have a professional learning community where there's representatives from every school in that professional learning community. And we involve them in kind of the newest, greatest trends in technology and give them a chance to take ownership of starting a PLC in their school or starting a PLC in their what we call a cluster, but a geographic zone. So we try to support them to kind of go off and start their own PLCs that are going to grow the knowledge within their geographic areas or their tier levels.
Now, Ryan, in your school, how do you handle that sort of integrated professional development and professional learning opportunities? You know, Governor Wise, you like to say that teachers need to be educational designers, but getting them there can be is an important piece of work.
It is, and it can actually be a challenge because obviously in any large school building, you have your spectrum of classroom teachers. And What we've really done is, and it's similar to what Keisha's talking about. I love her approach and what they're doing in Nashville. But what we've done is we've really looked at professional learning communities as a way to bridge that gap. We've done the same thing and connected it with all of our work towards preparing for the Common Core. And we've been able to connect those dots together. So in our conversations about preparing for the Common Core and what we're going to need to do and where we need to push our curriculum and where we need to push our instruction in the classroom, we're having those. At the same time, we're having conversations about digital learning and what benefit digital learning can bring to this conversation and how we can change instruction in the classroom. So one of the big things is to not compartmentalize it, because I think when you separate everything that's happening here in Maryland, we're also dealing with new teacher evaluations. So if you separate everything and you talk about teacher evaluation and then you talk about Common Core and then you talk about what we need to be doing with technology, it feels like this mass is just getting thrown on the classroom teacher. And so a lot of it is about the approach that you bring from a systemic or a building level to the classroom.
Can I just jump in on that? Because, you know, my wife is in her 32nd year of teaching. And when she was first hired in a one school district with one class per grade 32 years ago, and first new teacher hired in 12 years, she was by default the ed tech expert on staff, right? And so she felt confident. And she would tell you there was a point during her career where there was a lapse. And I think it can be intimidating. I think it can be, as Keisha and Ryan have said, you know, the programs and systems they put in place to address that. One of the things we have to do culturally is say, it's okay to feel like I can ask a question. You know, I mean, it is intimidating at all levels. What we're trying to do is a heavy, heavy lift. And I think what we have to do is say to one another, it doesn't matter what your role is, teacher, principal, superintendent, board member, what have you, it's okay to raise your hand and say, I don't get this. I need some help with this. Who can partner with me to support me? And I think that goes for the programs that Ryan and Keisha are saying they have in their districts, because it's important within the culture to say, I want to learn this. I need you to help me figure this out. I mean, I think that it's hard sometimes. We're human beings. It's hard to be able to raise your hand and say, I want to learn this. But if we are lifelong learners, as we all assert to be, and we want to be. I need you to help me be that. You know, I want to be able to say that.
And I've been struck by the number of teachers with the experience level of your wife who's and incidentally, given how you look and she looks, she must have started when she was 10. But must have been early before real certification, but alternate certification. But in a serious note, what I've been struck by teachers that I consider having significant experience, 15, 20, in some cases 30 years, how many who have said, yes, I had problems getting started, but now I feel like I'm really teaching.
Absolutely, I'm in.
It has empowered me.
No question. Yeah, absolutely agree. Yeah.
And one thing we hear a lot.
If I could jump back.
Oh, sure thing, Keisha. Go ahead.
I'm sorry, but I just wanted to echo what Brian said and say that, you know, it's really never okay to say, because I feel like as a teacher I have limitations with the my familiarity with technology, so therefore I'm not going to teach with technology or I'm not going to use it in my classroom. And that's where having a coach or an instructional designer or a PLC comes in really handy, because you do have teachers out there, especially with the teacher evaluation being what it is in most states, that say, I'm going to do what's safe, and sometimes technology isn't safe, and that's really not what's right for our kids. They need to have exposure to technology so that they can be prepared for the world that is beyond school, and it's full of technology.
Yeah. Is there also, let me ask those of you who are practitioners along that subject, so we're getting a new generation of teacher, those who are just coming out of teacher preparation. So obviously they grew up, they're in their early 20s, they grew up wired, they're digital natives, not immigrants like me. And yet that doesn't, simply because they're wired for the personal use of technology, they still need instruction and preparation on teaching with it, don't they?
Yeah, I know, that's
absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
One thing I know, one of the things we've seen in the field when we visited schools is that sometimes those more experienced teachers are the ones who embrace the technology first, because they have had the experience of seeing that you always have to be open to new ways to teach, you always have to be open to new ideas, whereas the younger teachers may not have had the experience to pick up on that, which is an interesting, you would expect the younger teachers to be the ones working the social media in the classroom, and it's not always that way.
Yeah, I think you're right, and I think that's the programs that Keisha and Ryan are talking about that are doing that exact thing. I mean, I think, my wife was out of the classroom for 10 years as a reading specialist, then the program got cut, went back in the classroom with first graders. She said, oh my gosh, I hope I can do this. It was her team of first grade colleagues, she attributes the credits for helping her make that transition back into the classroom, helping her be successful. The same thing applies here to technology. How are we supporting one another in that context, in that culture, to be successful as colleagues?
And on that subject of being, of working as colleagues and collaborating, Ryan and Keisha, both of you are from fairly large school districts. My question to you would be, so are, with digital learning and digital and technology, are you able to develop, you know, are teachers able to develop professional learning communities outside the school using these digital tools?
So I can answer that quickly, and then I'll let Keisha respond. But in my particular case, absolutely. So my teachers, you know, the great example of that would be on kind of both ends of the spectrum. My special education teachers are sharing ideas and collaborating with other special educators in my school system and around the state to come up with activities that can help support the curriculum and move students in the direction that we need for all of our students to be college and career ready. At the same time, on the other spectrum, my AP teachers are collaborating constantly. My advanced placement teachers are collaborating constantly with other advanced placement teachers around the country. So, you know, that's one of those great examples. You know, when I started teaching, the door was shut in the classroom, and I taught. And if I was going to collaborate with somebody, it was going to be somebody down the hallway. And that has drastically changed. And I see that every day in this building.
Yeah, and we do very much the same thing. We also moved to 3 years ago to online professional development for our teachers. So they can take a professional development day and participate in a webinar like this, or they could participate in webinars that we have within district, or online professional development that we build within district. All the PLCs have an online component, so they're all connected across the district. With 150 schools, you have really no choice. And we model that. So the superintendent has a PLC with all of the principals that he monitors discussion boards, and he monitors webinars. He puts an online PD up for principals. So, our position is you can't put an expectation on teachers that you wouldn't put on anybody else. So all of us participate in a various amount of online professional development. The other interesting thing that I think is coming out in our district next year is we're marrying our learning management system, which houses all of our online professional development and our online courses and blended courses for students, with an instructional management system. So when we move to that, we'll have teachers will be able to look and see other teachers that might be teaching similar subjects, similar content that particular week, and create their own professional learning communities almost instantaneously through the data that they can see in this instructional management system. I think that's going to be really powerful.
Absolutely, it sounds like it. And one thing that I'm also hearing is that, professional learning communities, such as those you might find through social media, those are essentially free. They take time, but they don't actually take cost. And cost is another really important issue that you raised, Governor. We have a question coming from Karen in Minnesota about the funding issue. How do we make these tough decisions in the tough funding times that we're facing? Have you heard from, what are you seeing in the field at this time?
First of all, you don't have a choice. Because if you have 35 states that are spending less per pupil today than they were in 2008, and that's not going to get much better. If you have a number of our districts as hard strapped as they are, we know that property tax revenues, the basis for many school district support, we know that property tax revenues do not rise even as fast as the economy grows, because it takes a lot longer for reassessment and reappraisal. So for a host of reasons, it doesn't get better financially. And so we don't have a choice anymore about whether or not we continue delivering education the same way, essentially the same way that we have since the University of Bologna 800 years ago, with one teacher standing up in front of 25 students and lecturing. And teachers know that that's not the best way to teach and to boost learning outcomes. And so the reality is that we want technology. Digital learning is critical for to be used and employed in a proper way, an effective way, to boost student learning outcomes. But does it also produce some cost efficiencies along the way? If, for instance, you have a data system that is enabled in software that enables a teacher to get real-time information, if you free that teacher up from having to take 120 papers home to grade at night in a secondary school, now think of the additional hours that teacher has to teach. My goodness. If you, for instance, undertake other initiatives that enable you to save dollars in one area, for instance, professional development, $8 to $17 billion, depending upon whom you speak to, spent each year on what many would question how much of it is truly valid and worthwhile. So if you're now able to allocate some of that to a more professional, to a better professional learning communities, if in turn you're going to move from textbooks to digital content, yes, you'll be paying for that content, but not the same way that you are for textbooks. So the important thing here, as one person pointed out to me recently, is you don't look at it as we're simply adding more per student to it. What is it that we're doing that's more effective, efficient, boost student outcomes? And somebody made this point, the term we use is it's not just about layering on. You just don't slap a netbook on top of a textbook and say, we've got a digital learning program. You replace that textbook with a system. And so when you use that netbook, iPad, or whatever it is. So it's about how you design your system and you make it becomes more cost effective. I want to stress one thing. This is not about laptops for layoffs. It is not about diminishing the role of teaching. We're talking about digital learning in a blended learning environment. That means the traditional public school. And we're talking about enhancing, not diminishing, the role of teacher. And incidentally, boosting student outcomes for all students, not just a percentage. And so a whole, and then finally one note, and then I'll be relatively quiet. One note is that if the Alliance has done a lot of work on what's the economic return on investment. And so there's a payback, because the more students you graduate college and career ready, if you go to the Alliance website for and click on your state or one of 220 metropolitan areas, we can show you the direct return you get by increasing your graduation rate 50 or cutting your dropout rate 50%, increase your graduation rate to 90%. And so there's an immediate, or a fairly immediate return on investment right there, as well as, I say, the cost efficiencies that you build in over time as you implement digital learning.
Yeah, and I think this financial question, the budget question, loops back to your first question about policy and making sure that everybody, the teachers, the community, everybody's at the table, having that conversation about creating that unified vision for our district about where it is we want to go, and being transparent about our resources. These are hard decisions. I mean, anybody who's been on a school board, as I was even 10 or 12 years ago, making cuts, even then, it's even harder now. Diminished resources, higher expectations, critically important decisions to make. They're not necessarily easy, even when you do all this homework, but if you can have all the stakeholders at the table and you're sharing the conversation with your community and you've got them engaged, you can at least say, you know, we are trying to make our very best decisions for our students and our teachers and our classrooms. Again, hard decisions, but if you've got the players at the table, you know at least that you are, you've engaged all the folks that have something to say about the process.
Absolutely. And Keisha, you mentioned that when you talked about how you reached out to the community. Ryan, you made the same case about how important that is. Brian, from your experience as a school board member, I hear a lot of superintendents say that they sometimes they reach out to the community, they get nothing back. How are there strategies that you've seen that are effective for actually making that connection?
The whole notion of community engagement is always a challenge for districts. At a period of time when I was doing some consulting, we would go in and do what we called a community audit. And we would sit down and bring in, literally sit down and do focus groups with every stakeholder group you can imagine and ask people to come in. And there's a long story that we don't have time for, but the bottom line is meaningful engagement, a genuine effort by a district to go through a process like that, sends a message to those stakeholders that you really are genuinely trying to get that information, particularly when they see it affecting policy decisions. And so I think the difficulty hasn't gotten any easier over the years in terms of community engagement, but I think it's the genuine nature with which you engage your community and ask them to come to the table, open the door, come in, and offer input into that decision-making process. It's not just about doing a survey and getting the results, although that's important. You got to take a pulse. There are a number of levels and measures that you can use to engage folks, and I think half the battle is sending the message that you are genuinely trying to engage them in the conversation. And if you do that, it can go a long way. But there is no silver bullet to the notion of that challenge of true community engagement. Because I can tell you, even when you try, sometimes you miss somebody and then you've got that issue. So it's not easy, but it's about demonstrating over time that it's a genuine commitment to the community.
Absolutely. Now, one other question before we get close to wrapping up. I don't want to cut anybody off too early. What else are we seeing in terms of the correlation? How do we know that we're going to see results from this between these efforts? This is a question from Fred coming in and across the email. How do you see the results playing out? How do you track that?
I'd go to our practitioners.
Exactly. Yeah. So Keisha, Ryan, how do you track your real results?
Well, I'll start and then I'll turn it over to Ryan if you don't mind. What we've seen is, you know, we have a tremendous data warehouse, so we keep up with the work that we do with individual schools, and we're able to kind of correlate the work that we're doing with the particular grade level and subject area emphasis with results. So last year in the schools that we worked in, that we saw in one particular school, their writing scores went up 2 points. Because the principal and faculty feel very strongly that it's because of the work that we did in implementing netbooks for every student and how we helped design how we worked with teachers to design lessons that would focus on that. Our graduation rate went from 58% to 89% because of the way that we started to blend the online learning opportunities with face-to-face learning opportunities and giving students a chance to accelerate their pathway through online learning. So I think that, you know, it does pay off. It is hard work. It does pay off. You may not see a direct correlation, but you will definitely see higher engagement in classrooms. You'll definitely see more higher interest in school, and so you're going to see an increase in attendance, and you're definitely going to see teachers reconnecting with their passion to teach.
I just to follow up with what Keisha said, I think, and actually she caught it right there at the end, I think what we're seeing here at Patapsco is our investment over the course of the last 4 years has resulted, and the big indicator for me is our attendance. Our attendance in this building, and again, I go back to a dramatic increase in our free and reduced meals rate here in this building, but our attendance is increasing. Students are coming to school on a regular basis, and when they're not, we're able to reach them through different pathways because we have those opportunities to do it, and we know that attendance is a critical indicator when we talk about dropout rate in America's public high schools. And so for me, that's a huge deal. I can't stand here and pinpoint and give you all these data points that directly correlate the technology to the differences that we're seeing here in this building. But I can tell you that if you were here and if you were walking these halls, the environment would tell you the story. And what I can say is students are coming to school, our dropout rate is decreasing, and we're keeping more kids engaged. And it goes back to what Keisha said. It's because the teachers are getting that passion back, or whether they're new, they're finding the passion, and they're teaching in ways that they never thought possible before.
I just want to say, you know, here we have Ryan and Keisha. They're not only ISTE rock stars, they're rock stars among so many in our schools around the country that are leading this and are making themselves available collegially, as we were saying earlier, to support one another around the country. And I think these are the people who are out there stepping up and saying, I'm doing it, I'm learning some hard lessons. As Keisha said earlier, we succeed here, we fail here, we learn, we move on, we grow. These are the people that are out there to support one another as they address these very difficult challenges. And they're there, they're ready to help.
And we really appreciate ISTE and you're in all those involved with ISTE and making that information available.
Absolutely.
To a wide group of people.
Well, and that leads me, Bob, to this is really just sort of the first step in some new work the Alliance is taking on. Do you want to talk a little bit about the items that we're putting out today?
It absolutely is, and I'm very excited about what's happening today in addition to this webinar. So today the Alliance is releasing some important new materials and tools to follow up on this discussion that we've been having. We're releasing, first of all, a new report I've already mentioned. The nation's schools are stepping up to higher standards. It talks about the decisions that have to be made in the next 2 years. It talks about, lays out that strategy for doing that, and a lot more to come. So we have a new report coming out today. Accompanying that, we have a new infographic, and we also have a new web portal, which are the first steps in a major effort by the Alliance and partnering with a number of membership-based organizations like ISTE and many others to help district leaders make smart, far-reaching decisions about implementing education technology that supports teachers and improves student outcomes in the public schools, grades kindergarten, pre-K to 12. The links to all of this information are on the homepage of the Alliances for Excellent Education's website at www.all4ed.org, or just go www.alliancefor.excellenteducation, all one word, to get access to these important new materials, the report, the web portal, as well as the infographic.
That's absolutely right. And to keep up to date, you can also follow us on Twitter at all4ed, and you can also find us on Facebook, same abbreviation, all4ed. All of these materials should also be available on the webpage for this webinar. If they're not there now, they'll be there when we post the archive for this webinar in a day or two. So you can forward this to folks. They can watch it. You can watch it again at any time. We are just about out of time, as much as I would love to sit here and keep talking. So I do really want to thank you, Brian, for coming into our studio today. And thank you so much, Keisha and Ryan, for joining us on the phone, taking time away from the very important work that you're doing. So thank you again for joining us on this topic, and stay tuned for more.
Tuned.
That's as they say, stay tuned for more. As always, you
thank
can.
You.
Yes, thank you so much. Again, as always, you can email us your thoughts on this webinar and suggest topics for other webinars at alliance@allfored.org. Thank you for joining us and have a great afternoon.